Well, I wanted to talk a bit about sex and drugs, basically, and not from the viewpoint that you should not use or anything. That used to be the answer that everybody gives out of fear. But if I take it seriously and I look at my my teenage years, I always say heroin I didn't use, because if I gotta name everything I did use, it's such a long list. So I do think it's possible to have a good and healthy life and have a fun life having used drugs, and it can be fun to use them with sex. But let it be known that I do work with addictions, and that I do think that there's big risks sometimes in it as well. So let's try to be, yeah, realistic in it. And I think if anybody works with addictions, with other types of sex out of the normal, quote unquote, sex, shame is killing, and I hope everybody remembers that. And I certainly wouldn't want to shame anybody in any way. If we look at drugs, it's basically there's drugs, there's different drugs, there's fun use, there's functional use, and there's medicinal use, and there's sex, of course. And I often work when I do the Chemsex groups. Often make the difference between intimate sex and the more shameless sex. And of course, there's different routes. We can go from drugs to sex. Just for instance, a few to try to get in somebody's pants, trying to create instant intimacy in a party. That's why we use drugs for sex. There's also the other route. I want sex, and therefore I use drugs for erection maintenance. That's, I always say, you for instance, cocaine makes you last longer if you get it up, because cocaine, after using it for a while, is an erection killer. But in the beginning phase, it does keep your erection up better. A lot of people want really a lot of energy and want to be had about the God feeling can be great. It can be used for anal relaxation. And of course, there are things that, it's not clear whether it's drugs or sex. A lot of people are depending on drugs, basically, to have a party atmosphere. Altered consciousness sex can be really an interesting thing to explore, and can be else actually healthy to find out things about your own sex. And then quite another thing is that for some people, using drugs at a camp party, chemsex party, is an entrance to the gay scene, how to get there, how to introduce yourself. Drugs can, of course, have a medicinal use, like anti-anxiety and special the anti-shame, which is often social anxiety, and it can be used for pain relief sometimes, and that's not only physical pain but also emotional pain, trauma relief, and a lot of us, well, there is a bigger chance. You can see there's a bigger chance of meeting people with traumas out of the LGBTQ area, because there's 25 bigger chance of being addicted. And I think that has mostly to do with the social climate and shaming and the traumas we've lived. I like to very briefly make a distinction between the biological addiction, where you feel the hunger towards a drug, and the emotional dependence, where you need to use a drug to not feel or not think or not experience things, or to do experience things. And that may lead to overuse, where there's a lack of experience, self-control. It's different things. It's often used in one breath, but it's different things. And I like to get things clear. And I also like to be clear that it's a bit of a spiral. It's not an on-off switch, but it's a 1 to 100% dial. We're not suddenly addicted, and there's never this one beer and then I'm an alcoholic. It starts with fun news and the fun sides of our life. Then it gets functional, and that's where we do learn that drugs can add things, and where, if we continue that, learn to unlearn other ways of, for instance, having the stamina. A lot of guys over 45 or 40 want to be younger. The ecstasy animal, the K-hole relaxation, quote unquote. Then it goes to daily use, and well, it goes down. Not really want to talk about that. I hope we're staying on the fun use area, and maybe sometimes functional. It's become functional, and if you remember, that's a thing, then you might try to learn something from the drug, and I will perhaps tell something a bit about that later on. There's different chems, and if we have different drugs, there's basically three things drugs do. It's either stimulating, it's either relaxing, or it's perception altering. If we look at uppers, downers, and trippers, the stimulants, the relaxants, and trippers, that's so you can have every drug somewhere in between these three points. If we have a look at different drugs, for instance, coffee, well, we all know in the morning coffee is clearly an upper. If we look at cannabis, that's rather clearly somewhere in between tripper, and then there's new ways of there's certain hashish which get you rather stoned and slow. There's weed that gets you more up and active. So it kind of differs, but it's over there. If we look at nicotine, well, everybody says, well, that's such a relaxation when I smoke my cigarette. But basically, if we look at nicotine, it's an upper. Being addicted to nicotine, it makes you feel relaxed when you basically heal your crash and get your new drug. So feeling that relaxation is often why people think it's a relaxant. And alcohol, well, it is a downer, but because we tend to down our thoughts first with alcohol, because these areas of our brain are more subtle. Because we break the break of our thoughts, basically we get uninhibited and dance more like crazy because of alcohol, but it is a downer. And if you have a look at all these different drugs that we're going to talk about, it's got its own place in the triangle. I like to mention the risks. I'm going to talk more like upperly about drugs. I like to talk about risks, and most basically I want to say it's complicated. The biological addiction of a drug, depending on the drug, basically having to do with the amount of dopamine it gets in your brain, that differs from drug to drug. The dependence risk, so what does the drug do and why do you like it so much, is depending mostly on psychological risk factors. Overusage is not the same as overdose. And a drug being poisonous, of course, has to do with overdose, but it's not always the same as the health damage a drug does in the longer time. Let's have a look at different drugs. Alcohol, of course, it's a legalized hard drug, basically. We don't see it as such often, but it is, if you see the addiction risk. It gets you, as said, quite uninhibited. And especially for sex, it's you release some shame maybe, but it isn't too good for your erections, as most people know, especially when you've drunk more. So that's often where people find themselves drinking to release themselves and to have sex, and then noticing they're basically too drunk to have sex. It's often used as a kind of persuaded consent, and I think we should be really clear that if somebody doesn't say no anymore, that's quite something else as saying yes. And when we talk about alcohol and other drugs on parties, sex parties, it's relatively risky to combine with other drugs. I will talk about that later. And as said, it's more addictive than most people think. Cannabis, it has both the THC and the CBD. When you get stoned, relaxed, or more like the feeling of things, and it heightens the senses of touch, and it can enhance intimacy as well. You can smoke it, you can eat it. That's the difference. It's not too good for the lungs to smoke, but it's really a relaxing thing, and releases some of the inhibitions, not as strong as alcohol, but it releases some inhibitions. And people often find themselves, hey, I've learned to enjoy touch, and I've learned to enjoy slow sex through the route of cannabis. CBD can sometimes be used in lubes or direct on the skin. THC can enhance other drugs. And I help you remind that oil, and of course CBD oil as well, is bad for most condoms. So if you use condoms and CBD oil, be careful you choose the right condoms. Poppers nitrous oxide, of course, quite different in the way they work on our brain and our body. But the combining factor is they both tend to knock out your thinking brain just for minutes or seconds. And basically that's often used to enhance the experience of orgasm or create more relaxation, and that's especially for poppers, because it relaxes the white muscle tissue. To relax more during moments of anal penetration, where that's specially used for. It's sometimes hard to time these things, and it's not easy to have this. You've had your rush already from poppers, for instance. It's already gone, and then you come. That's a bit of a bummer. And it can also be that you're almost coming. You have this rush of your popper, and then, well, basically the relaxations of this muscle say whoop, and there goes the erection. Furthermore, poppers is nasty fluid on the skin. Wash it away right away. Don't breathe it. Don't put it in your nose. And be careful with canister applied N2O. It can really freeze your skin, so that some nasty burns have happened there. So burning and freezing is basically the same. So use balloons, I'd say. GHB, it's an abandoned anesthetic. The risk, of course, is that the fun dose is not far apart from the overdose. And people are sometimes a bit too relaxed about it, I think. He's doing a GHB sleep. Well, he might be killing brain cells in such moments. But it does create really uninhibited and shame-free states of mind that can be fun if you don't overdose it. Don't combine it with alcohol. I'll talk about that a little bit later. And remind yourself that GHB is more addictive than we thought before. the GABA, the brake pedal in our nervous system, gets disrupted by GHB. We don't produce our own GABA anymore, and therefore we get really dependent on the GHB. MDMA, ecstasy, is one of the first designer drugs. It's a good thing to learn to enjoy things. And you see people really enjoying touching somebody, and it can give this loving state of mind, and you feel good. You wouldn't want to be dependent of using ecstasy, because a lot of people have this feeling, I should take a pill before going to a sex party or a swingers party. And I think that's a pity. I think you can learn to enjoy the world, and you can learn to enjoy simple things like, it feels great to breathe. And that's a thing where often people say, it did enhance the quality of my life. But if you're not able anymore to intimate or in a sex mood to start your parties, then it's not so much addiction, but it's more like dependence. Crystal meth. I'm not really prepared to talk about crystal meth. Yes, it makes you feel like a god, as I've heard. But often in really fast, that dies, and sex life dies too. And I'd like to remember that, and I help you remember that its nickname is Tina, which is short for there is no alternative. And if you look at the dopamine, as said, the sign of the biological addiction risk. Good food gives you a dopamine dot of 150. Well, I can see orgasm 200, snorting cocaine 350, crack 500, and then we got crystal meth with 1200. So I don't really want to go into it much. You can snort it, you can smoke it, but I advise against it. Cocaine, snorting, it is addictive, about as addictive as alcohol. If you smoke it, it gets faster in your brain, and you've cleaned it during the smoking preparation things. So that gets it, actually makes it far more addictive. So I advise to not smoke, but if you snort it, it can really give you this confident feeling. You dare to party, you dare to do things, you're easier into doing things. It can also be used as a really expensive way to anesthetize the butthole. And I always ask, do you want to? Well, maybe people have different ideas about that, but I don't know. I'm not too enthusiastic about that. And basically it's rather dependence created for people that have shamed themselves or feeling shamed, and living as a gay, people often shame you, and people are often, if we read our The Velvet Rage, people are often more shamed and ashamed than they themselves recognize. Be careful, don't fall in that trap, basically. 3MMC, and also speed, it's a bit near. 3MMC is a bit in between ecstasy and cocaine. Speed is more aggressive. It's basically to give you energy and self-awareness and to be able to have a prolonged physical activities. As fucking might be. Do drink enough water and don't overheat yourself. But it feels good. It has a bit of this enjoyment ecstasy thing, and a bit of this I'm important from cocaine. Speed is more like just energy and nothing else. And you can really do things that you otherwise couldn't, but it's wearing you out, and it's bad for basically the heart and blood pressure and things. Both are often not so good for erections, or and especially orgasms, where you can perhaps fuck longer. But sometimes it kills the ability to orgasm. Ketamine is an anesthetic, and it creates really fun-like and dream-like dissociative states of mind, which are really fun. And it can also be used to anesthetize the butthole. Again, do you want to? And mind the bladder, because if you've got bladder problems as well already, do mind the risks. And it's a really enjoyable thing to do while fisting. But if you give which it's called booty bumping, if you give a drug through the anus, be really careful what you do, because firstly, it's a really delicate tissue over there, and you can burn it. Most drugs are sour or blocking on the opposite of sour. Rather aggressive substances. So it can really burn and create burns in your insides, which you don't feel that much, which are there. And another thing is, there's a real overdose danger, because if you do booty bumping, it gets right into your system, and it gets really fast into your head and your whole system. Whereas if you smoke, or if you especially eat it, it gets to go through the stomach, being digested, being more or less also being diminished. So do inform yourself about the amounts. And another thing is, you don't want to be together in a K-hole. And a K-hole, that's a state of mind where you really can't move anymore. You can't do a thing anymore. You're just tripping and breathing, that's all that you can do. That's dangerous if everybody's in a K-hole, or everybody. And so I always say, one person at a time, the active partner, especially if used for fisting, the active partner shouldn't be using data. Now, if you have a look at the party scene, there's often all kinds of drugs around, and that can also be dangerous sometimes. I've had people being in a K-hole. I've heard people being in a K-hole really not wanting to have anything else but what they were using, but because they were basically unable to do anything, somebody came by and blew like crystal meth crack pipe in their inhalation. So they suddenly passively smoked a crack suddenly, which they really didn't want. So be careful in which chemsex parties areas you go, and talk about drugs, talk about what you want and what you don't want. But what I wanted to talk about is that often combining different uppers and downers is what we call a polyuse drug, like different drugs at the time. If we have downers like GHB and we go down, that's can be fun. And if we have alcohol, that also goes down. That's a bit longer, but that's also something that goes down, and we haven't even used that much, but because it adds up to each other. If we add them up, it suddenly goes off the charts and people die because of that. So be careful combining downers with downers. Downers with uppers are, of course, then different. If I smoke or I snort cocaine and I am feeling too wired and I think, well, I'm going to have a drink to cool things down, that works. If you take the line that combines the combined, which is mostly because you the uppers and subtracted from the downers, you see what the combined line does. And what sometimes happens is that people, they snort cocaine and then they drink and then snort cocaine and then they drink and then they, because they don't feel drunk, they sometimes drink really, really a lot. And that is in itself dangerous. They drink a dangerous amount, but because they use medicinal cocaine as an upper, the combined curve would look something like this, which is, and that's great if the money doesn't run out or your dealer doesn't go home. Because then, if the second one's not there, people die on a later point that they, from the alcohol, they didn't notice they drank. And well, it's a lot. People die from that. Variables differ, as said, amounts taken. If we smoke, the second heartbeat, it's in our head. If we slam, it gets in our head the moment we release the rubber. If we do booty bumping, it gets really fast. If we snort, it does take some time to get through the nostrils and the tissues in our bloodstream. If we swallow, it takes more time. But that's all different. Of course, the amount of drugs to my body weight. And how's my health? And how's my liver function? And actually, a lot of drugs do differ with stress levels. Basically, it's combining drugs is really hard to understand what am I doing. And if you want to combine things, I always say try in lower doses before going, oh no, he says it's able, you're able to. Well, okay, then it's okay. But if you combine things, unexpected things can happen. There is a special drug combination chart for the people who do like to see it. Maybe you like to take a, if you're interested in it, you know now where to find it. Otherwise, just ask me, I'll let you know. But it says basically every drug that works or doesn't work, because it basically different, dangerous. There's a lot of info to be found on drugsinfo.nl or Peaky Tripsit. Things are coming up on my site as well. And if we end, I'd like to end with a thing, combining sex and drugs, it can be big fun. But do inform yourself beforehand and do find different sources. And why would you trust those sources? I always like what Buddha says. Apparently Buddha said to his followers, if you ever meet Buddha along the way, kill him. Don't trust anybody and remind yourself, why would I trust this person about this? That's basically me. And I think drugs are a reality of this world. Shame has a role. And I'm really, really interested in what people have to say and have to think about these things. Get out. The brothers gonna work it out. The brothers-